I, Ms. Tejashree Ingre, welcome you all for the today's webinar on awareness and a training on intellectual property rights. Let me introduce our today's guest speaker, Dr. Ajay Thakur sir. Sir is an assistant controller of a patent and designs government of India. Dr. Ajay Thakur sir has done MSc in biochemistry, postgraduate diploma in business management, masters of management sciences, MPhil, PhD in marketing management, LLB, LLM in Intellectual Property Rights and Information Technology. Sir had completed online certificate courses from World Intellectual Property Organization, that is WIPO. Sir had worked as Senior Scientific Officer in Hindustan Antibiotics Limited, Pimpri Pune, till 25th of September 2003. Presently, sir working as an Assistant Controller of a Patents and Design Group A Gadget Officer in Patent Office, Government of India, Ministry of Commerce and Industry, Mumbai. Dr. Ajay Thakur sir has conducted over 500 patent awareness programs in various industries, universities, colleges, schools, and various seminars, workshops in Western Zone of India. We are really excited for today's session, sir. We request you to start our session, today's session.
Okay. Shall we start?
Yes, sir.
Okay. So I'll share my presentation. Is that visible?
Yes, it is visible.
Okay. So, a very good afternoon to all the delegates, respected dignitaries on the dais, and my dear friends. So, as Madam has given my brief introduction, and I'm working with Patent Office since 2003, we have a collaboration with Government of India, and we are as a government employee. So we are presently celebrating our 75 years of independence, and that is Azadi Ka Amrut Mahotsav, and under which Government of India, along with Patent Office and Ministry of Commerce and Industry, we have taken up a mission. That mission is National Intellectual Property Awareness Mission, that is NIPAM. And we have taken the task. The mission is to train 1 million students from different fields of education, that may be at school level, that may be at graduation level, post-graduation level, including faculties. So to create the awareness of intellectual property, the mission is under the name of NIPAM, and our Honorable Prime Minister has given nod to this program, and with the help of them and along with our ministry, we are here to conduct the awareness program on intellectual property rights. Okay, now coming to what is, every day you come across this word IPR. So let me introduce what is IPR. IPR is a collective term for intellectual property rights. So when every day you hear this word, that is IPR. So IPR is nothing but the intellectual property right. Now, what is intellectual property right? Rights, we know. When we own something, we have a right for that thing. But what is intellectual property? That many people are not aware of, or many people may be aware of, but all the intellectual concepts are not clear. And what kind of things are to be registered, and what kind of things are that to be considered under what domain? So that has to be very clear. And I suppose there is a lack of awareness in this field. So to make aware, we are going ahead with this intellectual property rights seminar, webinar. So intellectual property very broadly classifies, or mainly means, deals with the rights which relate result from the intellectual activity. Now that activity may be in the form of industrial work, that may be in the form of scientific work, or that may be in the form of literary or artistic work. So basically understand that intellectual property refers to the creation of the mind. Now what is the creation of mind? See, the greatest gift given by God to mankind is the brain. And brain has the ability to think, and think in terms of creating different ideas, and that ideas are made into some articles of trade, and that articles are nothing but the intellectual property or that things. Now, coming to the present scenario wherein intellectual property is very important part. So basically, when you talk of intellectual property, you just basically understand that it is nothing but the creation of mind. Now, then what is that creation of mind deals with? Now, when we talk of industrial property, the industrial property includes patents for invention, then trademarks, industrial designs, geographical indications, and all that. Along with that, another part is the copyright, which covers the issues of literary work, artistic work, dramatic work, musical work, sound recording, cinematographic work. So basically understand the intellectual property is nothing but the property as a result of human intellect. The human brain thinks in a way, and that that thinks whatever the idea, that whenever it is formed, expressed in some other or the other form, it gives the intellectual property, that may be in the form of industrial or that may be in the form of copyright. So basically you should understand that it is nothing but the property, just like another property, which gives the owner or the person or the creators of that property the right to have the property on his name, and nobody can use that property, just like our other things. So nobody can use that property without the permission of that person. So basically, when we come across the word property, property may be in the form of immovable property, that may be in the form of land, houses, building, the property which cannot be easily moved, or that property which cannot be moved from one place to another, that are the immovable properties. And then coming to movable properties, that may be in the form of car, pin drives, furniture. Then comes the other type of property, that is intellectual property. First of all, understand that intellectual property is an intangible property. When we talk of intangible property, that means this property is there, but it is not visible to the eyes. That is, we cannot see with the naked eyes. So basically, understand the example of what is intellectual property. Now, every day you use mobile phones, right? When we use the mobile phone, we know that it gives, you can send requests, you can use Facebook, you can use WhatsApp, you can send call, you can do messages, or all other things that which can be done with a mobile. But and you know that if the I press this kind of specific button, then that WhatsApp will open. If I press this kind of button, then that Facebook will open. If I press this kind of button, then I can call somebody. Similarly, we can use different forms of that mobile. Now, every day we are using this thing, but how that mobile works, nobody knows, or nobody takes care of that thing. How this mobile works, what is there, because of which the Facebook works, or because of which you can call from one person to another person, or we can take a snap, or you can do any other value added products from the mobile phone. So basically understand that there is an intellectual property embedded in the mobile phone, and which is not seen by visible eye, but it is present. You use mobile phone, but you don't know how it works, but it is present. Therefore, it is intangible in nature. You cannot see, it cannot be seen by naked eyes, but it is present. It is present, and it is working in some or form or some other form. So because of which that mobile functions or works in that way. Take any example of any electronic gadget, that may be of television, that may be of car, or that may be of any other things. So that basically understand that there is an intellectual property embedded in that article, and which is having some commercial value, and therefore it is an intellectual property, and that has to be protected, and necessarily protected under different laws. Now, what are these different laws, and what kind of domain and what kind of protection we give? Usually we in our patent office, we come across somebody writes a book, and he comes to us and comes to patent office and says, sir, I want to patent this book. or he writes some research article, or he writes some poem, or he writes some story, and he comes to patent office and he says, sir, I want to patent this story, I want to patent this book, or I want to do what kind of work with that thing. At that time, because we cannot blame him, but because of his unawareness, we have to tell him that this issue is not related to patents, and you cannot get a patent for a book, a patent for a book or an article. So you necessarily have to get it copyrighted. So that is what the different types of intellectual properties are. So basically, our aim is to clear the doubts. First of all, let me make clear that in simple words, intellectual property is the result of human intellect. It is an intangible property. There are different types of intellectual property, and that we will see in detail. Then coming to, I told you, there are 7 to 8 types of intellectual properties. Now, what kind of things are registered under that domain? That we will see separately, so that your concept regarding intellectual property rights will be cleared. So there are different types, that is patents, designs, trademark, geographical indications, copyright, semiconductor integrated circuits, layout, designs, then plant protection, varieties, and trade secrets. All these are different types of intellectual property. Now, what is the need of this intellectual property? So basically understand ki, what is there that needs to, why the IPR needs to be protected. We come across every day we come across new gadgets, and you see that today's newspaper becomes tomorrow's waste. Similarly, the product which you buy 2 months earlier or 1 year earlier has changed, has become absurd. For example, you take your mobile phone. After 2-3 years, you feel like, okay, I should change that phone. Or the technology gets improvement, and you see different variation, different types of mobile phone, or different types of television, or different types of car, or different types of things. So every day we feel that there is a improvement, or there is the because the technologies are changing rapidly. The technologies, today's technology becomes tomorrow's absurd thing. So technologies are changing rapidly. Then the investment. Now, when you talk of intellectual property, a lot of investment is required, labor is required, manpower is required, all the things, and different experimentation, different levels of management skills are required to be produce that intellectual property. And therefore, the investment in research and development, as well as production and marketing, are very high. Then product life becomes very shorter. I told you today's newspaper becomes waste tomorrow. So the article which you were using today will be getting absurd within a very short period of time. For example, we had Dabba television, then that came, then came age with the color television, then the improvement with the slight improvement we have came with the LCD player, then LED player, and the plasma TV. All these things are nothing but the development in the products of the television. So this is basically understand that all these things are leading to increase in price or increasing. So therefore, you understand that it is easily copyable. The idea can be easily copied. The person who makes the instrument can be easily copied. So some sort of protection and some sort of encouragement is required to be given to these persons, creators of the intellectual property. Therefore, the need of intellectual property arises. And we have a very well protected intellectual property regime under which different intellectual properties are registered and protected under the different laws that we will see later. So I told you that the creation of intellectual property requires lots of brain efforts. Apart from brain efforts, there are resources, labor, manpower, time, money, laboratories, all the things are required. So because of which it is very necessary that the intellectual property rights should be protected. Now coming to first intellectual property right. You might have seen these words, C. Where you have seen, can anybody tell me? Okay, I suppose all are muted. So I'll tell you. Generally, when you see any books or when you see any cassettes or any video recording or CD player or CDs, whenever you see this work, C, that means you should understand that the work is copyright protected. So in general terms, what is copyright? Copyright, does that mean you have the right to copy? Can anybody copy the right or copy the work of any other persons? No. Copyright is a legal term describing the rights given to the creators in their literary, artistic, musical, and dramatic work, including cinematographic work and sound recording. So whenever you come across this kind of thing, don't get confused. Okay, I want to get patent on this kind of work. Now, what is literary work? What is artistic work, musical work, dramatic work, cinematographic film work, and sound recording? That we will see. So first, basically understand that the copyright is given to whenever these kinds of rights are created, these are given to the person. So when you have an idea and you reproduce that idea in some form of the other, then the form which it takes, that if it is in the form of literary work, artistic work, dramatic work, musical work, sound recording, cinematographic film, then that that acquires the domain of copyright, and that has to be necessarily registered under the copyright. So once you register that thing, what copyright gives? The copyright gives the creator of the original work an exclusive right. Exclusive right means the only that person can be then can use it, usually for a limited period of time, and that may apply to wide varieties of intellectual, artistic form or other sort of works. So basically understand, once I get an idea, so that idea, and now you say that if I got the idea and I want that idea to be protected under copyright, then ideas cannot be copyrighted. The basic thing is understand the copyrighted work only exists when the ideas or the information themselves is expressed in some form. That may be in the form of book, or that may be in the form of some literature, or that may be in the form of painting, or that may be in the form of cinematographic work or music. So that when that kind of things are created, the copyright exists. Though Section 17 of copyright says that it is mandatory, it is not mandatory to register the copyright, but it is always advisable that you should always protect your copyrighted work, right? So basically, these are the rights which cover these different domains. Now basically understand what is literary work and what is all this kind of work, the under which what can be copyrighted. So when we talk of literary work may be in the following forms. If you write a book, if you write an article in newspaper, or you set up some question paper, or you write some catalogs or any dictionaries, or if you use any lecture reduced to writing, or any computer software or program, or any lyrics, if you produce that thing, that has to be necessarily registered under the copyright. So don't get confused. Don't get confused that I want a trademark, or I want a patent on the book, or a news article on newspaper. Basically, this is the domain under which literary work comes, and basically they are registered under the copyright. So whenever you keep in mind that whenever you come across this word literary work, that may be in the form of all these things, so that is necessarily a domain under of copyright, and therefore that has to be registered under the Copyright Act. Similarly, when you talk of artistic work, that artistic work may include drawings, maps, diagrams, plans or charts, then any paintings, then diagram, chart work, any work of sculpture, engraving, advertisement poster, or industrial and engineering drawings, photographs, all these things form an artistic part, and artistic works is necessarily registered under the copyright. So don't get confused. So basically understand what kind of things are registered under the artistic work. So whenever you come across this kind of paintings or any work of artistic work, that has to be necessarily protected under the Copyright Act. Then coming to musical work and dramatic work. Now, what is musical work? Musical work may be in the form of graphical notation or sound recording, as well as the dramatic work may exist in the following forms. That may be in the form of play, recitation, choreographic work, dumb show, fixed in writing, then script, scenario, or any cinematographic film. So whenever you come across this kind of things, you understand that this is the domain of copyright, and therefore that has to be necessarily registered under the copyright. Don't go and say that I want to patent a song which I have written, or I want to make a sound recording patented. So all that thing has to be necessarily cleared from your mind. So whenever you think of this kind of work, understand that this work falls under the domain of copyright, and therefore it has to be necessarily registered under the copyright. Then there are some broadcasters, right? You see the Kapil Sharma show, which is shown on Sony TV, because the Sony TV has acquired the rights from the producer of that show, and therefore the movie, therefore the play is seen on that channel only. And there are many sports channels wherein sports match have been relayed. For example, you see IPL on Sony Star or Sony Max. So whenever the channel acquires the right, nobody can broadcast that thing unless and until they get the permission from the broadcaster who has the broadcasting rights. So when you see come across many clips wherein when if India wins a match, or if somebody has won, for example, now that lady has won, Kaur has won Miss Universe, then the news are keeping on flashed on news channels. But wherever you see that new channel flashing that news, you see some channels courtesy of so-and-so channel or source is given that Star TV, or so source is given from Star Sports. These are nothing but the permissions taken by the channel, news channels, to show that kind of telecast. And therefore, small clips are permissible after taking the permission from the broadcaster. So these are also the broadcasting rights. They are also known as neighboring rights. Then coming to performers, again, the performers that may be actor, singer, musician, dancer, or acrobat, juggler, conjurer, snake charmer, or anyone who performs a circus act, puppet show, or any person delivering a lecture. So these are nothing but the performer and who performs, and therefore the performers are rights are also in existence, and that are also given under the copyright domain. Now I told you that section 17 of the Copyright Act says that though it is not mandatory, it is advisable. However, when I said it is advisable, because you should register your work. Why? Because I will tell you an example. There are many examples, but example which is right now or in front of me is with regard to the movie Fan. When the movie was produced by Yash Raj Films, and there was one person, Mahesh Dojode, who filed a litigation stating the fact that it was the work which he has produced in the name of Abhineta in 1997, and Yash Raj Films had infringed his copyright on the same. But when the matter went in court, Mumbai High Court, the court denied him an interim injunction on the ground because he has not registered that work, and he was not able to prove that how that work was produced by him, or how that work was copied from him by Yash Raj Films, and how the Yash Raj Films got access to his work. So he was not able to prove it. And therefore, the movie screening was allowed. So Yash Raj won the case and the movie was released. However, in this case, if the person had that work protected under the copyright, he would have easily got through much royalty, and then he would have easily stopped Yash Raj Film from releasing this movie. So basically understand that copyright, though it is not mandatory to register it, but it is always advisable that you keep your work copyrighted. A meager cost is there. Remove that myth that everything requires money. But once you protect these things, you get a benefit of exclusive monopoly right for that work and for a period of time. So this is what relates to copyright. I suppose these things have made your concept clear about the copyright. So whenever you think of copyright, you keep in mind, whenever you write some literary work, artistic work, musical work, or dramatic work, including sound recording or cinematographic work, that necessarily forms a domain under which comes under the domain of copyright, and therefore it has to be registered under the copyright. Now coming to another form, that is trademarks. So when you see trademarks, what comes to your mind? Now, in simple words, there are trademarks, there are service marks, there are certification marks. So these are nothing but the distinctive symbols that help the consumer to distinguish between the competing goods or services, and are a major part of the goodwill a company enjoys in the trade. Now, when I say these are the distinctive symbol, what comes to your mind? So basically understand that if you are going for a picnic, and or going somewhere out, and with in your car, and suddenly your mother asks, can I get some water? And then you stop at one shop, and go to the shop and ask for a mineral water. Usually you, what you say, what usually one says, usually one thing comes up when you talk of mineral water, one thing comes to your mind, and you simply almost out of 99% will go and say that ek bisleri dena, ek bisleri dena. So bisleri is nothing but the name. When you talk of mineral water, image is comes to your mind, that bisleri bottle comes in your mind, and that is nothing but a trademark. So once you know that, because you know, we are aware that bisleri produces good quality of water, and therefore it has some brand name and it has some value, and that is the goodwill of the company. So similarly, when you are thinking of buying a toothpaste, immediately one thing comes to your mind, that I should buy it a Colgate. Similarly, when you talk of salt, the Tata salt comes in your mind. Similarly, when you talk of or think of shoes, Bata shoes comes in your mind. So these are nothing but the brand names. These are the brand names which enjoy a goodwill. So whenever you come across, whenever you want to buy this kind of thing, a particular brand or particular name flashes in your mind. And that is nothing but the trademark. That the trademarks, once is a name of the enterprises which indicates that the product or the services belong to that person. And therefore, when you think of that thing, immediately that thing comes in your mind, that I should buy a Colgate test toothpaste, or I should buy a Tata salt, or I should buy a Bata shoes. Or you see many people saying, are ye banda to pura branded kapde use karta hai, ya branded things use karta hai. This branded things includes the trademarks. So these are the trade names which are used in the business, and therefore it has some commercial value. Nobody can use that symbol. So when you come across this kind of symbol, immediately you get idea that and this product belongs to Nike, or this product is of Puma, or this product, this symbol indicates that there is a McDonald's outlet, and McDonald's is having specific type of food or specific type of products which are having this kind of quality. So these are nothing but the trademarks which are going to indicate that these are the signs capable of distinguishing the goods or services of one enterprises from those of the other. Now, when you talk of doing some courier, or when you talk of doing sending some article or something information, then immediately you come across that SpeedPost, or there may be a Blue Dart or FedEx. All these are nothing but the service marks, because they are providing the services of courier. So whenever you come across, whenever you want to do something, immediately that if you want to send some information or letter or some other form of things, one that needs to be sent to another location, immediately you come across or that thing comes in your mind, that you may go with Blue Dart, then there is Vichare Courier, then all these things, then Indian Post, FedEx, all these things are the service marks. So they indicate that the Blue Dart gives a nice thing. So immediately when you are thinking of sending credit card, mostly that comes through Blue Dart, or some important documents are sent through Blue Dart. Why? Because they have a brand name, or they have a value, and they have the service providers, because people have faith in them, and people say, okay, they will do it. So that is what the trade name indicates. So basically, when you talk of these things, that may be a brand name, a tagline, or a slogan. So when you talk of LG, that indicates that life's good. Then there are McDonald's symbols stating the tagline, I am loving it. Nike, just do it. All these things are nothing but the taglines and slogans applied on articles of trade, which indicate that the product belongs to LG, or the product belongs to the Nike, and therefore they have some competitive edge. Similarly, we have ISI mark, Bismarck, and then registration, they say FSSI. All these are nothing but the certification marks. So whenever you think of the trademark, that word marks, device marks, that may be in the form of symbol, logos. So whenever you come across this symbol, you just identify that the product belongs to that product. And basically you see that whenever you see the word TM, that means the work is trademark. or that having a particular trademark. And when you see word R, that means the trademark is registered with us. So therefore, these are the nothing but the things. These are the marks which are applied on article of trade and which indicates that the product belongs to this company, or therefore they may have that kind of quality. So this is what relates to trademark. So I suppose trademark is clear with you. There are trademarks wherein or there are certification marks and there are also service marks. So when you call, think of trademarks, all this comes into your mind: Coca-Cola, Google, Intel, all these McDonald's, all these things are nothing but the trademarks. When you come think of a certification mark include ISI, ISO certificate, FSSAI, all these things are nothing but these certification marks. And then service mark, that service mark I told you, Indian Post or the companies providing services, that may be like insurance services or any banking sector, that banks, these are nothing but the service marks. So basically understand that trademarks enjoy a goodwill in the market, and because of that thing, one has a competitive edge over the other products. Now, I told you that once you think of, I told you that when you think of mineral water, Bisleri comes to your mind. So these are the things, these are the trademarks, right? Now, coming to another important intellectual property, that is a geographical indication. Now, when you talk of geographical indication, what is that? So when we think of Agra, two things come to your mind. One thing, what is famous in Agra? So one says that Taj Mahal is famous in Agra. But apart from that, when you talk of Agra, another thing comes, Agra ka Peta. So Peta is nothing but a geographical indication. Similarly, when you talk of Darjeeling, Darjeeling tea comes in your mind. Then when we talk of Alfonso Mango, that comes from Raigarh, Ratnagiri. Then oranges from Nagpur, Kolhapuri Chappal from Kolhapur, all Agra, Peta, Goa, Feni, all these things are nothing but the geographical indications. What are the geographical indications? So geographical indication is a sign, that is a sign used on goods that have a specific geographical origin and possesses quality or a reputation that is solely due to the place of origin. Now, when I say sign used on goods that have a specific geographical origin, because when you know, when we talk of oranges, Nagpur comes in your mind. When we talk of Alfonso Mango, Ratnagiri comes in our mind, or Konkan comes in our mind. Whenever we talk of grapes, Nasik comes in our mind. So these are nothing but the indicators indicating that the fruits or the goods or the certain products. For example, when you talk of Kolhapuri Chappal, one thing comes in your mind that it is from Kolhapur. Similarly, Solapuri Chadar from Solapur. All these are nothing but the indication or a sign used on certain products which corresponds to a specific geographical location. Such goods enjoy a competitive edge over the other goods because of their geographical origin, and therefore they are having a commercial value and it is protected. Now, just see one example, a regular example you see, whenever summer starts, you see many outlets in Pune also, or many outlets in Thane, stating that Alfonso Mango available here, Ratnagiri Mango available here, and they are charging, because they are charging some amount, and all 2-3 months you get abundantly lot of mangoes from Konkan. And Devgarh Mango is there, then Alfonso from Ratnagiri, all these things are there. Why this is having a geographical tag? Because when they have a competitive edge, what is that competitive edge? People are ready to pay more money. If you are given a choice that Hapus mangoes from Ratnagiri and some local mangoes from that place, then you will usually prefer the Hapus mango, because it's a big business. Now you see, when just when summer starts, you see how many shops are there in Thane which have started using selling these Ratnagiri mangoes. They go and bring it from there because that mango is of that particular quality, and that is due to the geographical origin. Ratnagiri mango, that is because of the origin, the climatic features are such that the mangoes produced in that that area has a particular quality, particular taste, and therefore they have a competitive edge and they have a commercial value, and that is necessarily coming under the geographical indication. So mind you, one thing I have to make it very clear, that though this is not an individual right, here a group of community of farmers or group of farmers or group of producers from that area come and send their proposal to our office. After our office verifying the details, then it is indicated that once the tag is given, after verification, it is clear that the talk should be given. Then after that, then the community or the farmers who have applied for that GI tag, they start selling the thing by putting that tag, which is having a competitive edge. Mind you, in export also, this deals with this has a commercial value. A lot of demand is there for these exported products from like mango, grapes, or many other things. So usually this is basmati rice, Darjeeling tea, Kanjivaram seal, Gheola paitani, all these things. Even Puneri pagadi is being registered. So these are the things which is having a geographical indication, the indicating that the place is that the product or the certain goods are belonging to that area. So this is one of the intellectual property which is having a commercial reach. People are ready to pay more fee, and therefore because of which you can go in for different geographical. So what is geographical indication? It merely tells that the product is produced in a certain place and had certain characteristic which is due to the place of production, or it indicates the indication of source on the product, that the product originates from the place indicated. So this is nothing but the geographical indication. Now coming to, I suppose geographical indication is very clear to you. Now coming to another industrial property, that is industrial designs. Now what is industrial design? Now when you talk of industrial design is an ornamental or aesthetic aspect of an article. What is that ornamental or aesthetic aspect of that article? That may be in the form of three-dimensional feature, or that may be in the two-dimensional form. And it has some visual appeal. And therefore, it becomes a kind of intellectual property that has to be registered. Now you see, you come across mobile phones. Now I'm giving you different shapes of mobile phones are there. Every day you come across different designs of mobile phone, then chairs, and then fans, and then bags, and then bottles. Every day, then clothes, then handicraft, then any watches, jewelry, fashion, or any other things. So wherever you see different shapes of things. Even you check for biscuits. Earlier we were having only square biscuits. Now you see there are circular, rectangular, different sort of dotted and some different heart shape. So these are nothing but the designs which are having a commercial aspect, that is the ornamental or aesthetic articles or aesthetic aspect. And usually it is appealing to eye. Now what is you see when you see of bottle, how many shapes or how many different kind of shapes of bottle are there? Then you see mobile phone, every day you come across. These are nothing but the industrial design, and usually they are applied on articles of trade. Now when you see this kind of chair, in Three Idiots, the bum chair was an instant hit. It's indicating that their design, though these are the chairs, but they have such a shape that it attracted the eyes, or it has the aesthetic appearance, and because of which it attracted the students. So many kindergartens or nurseries, or even in public small places where small children are there, these chairs were installed. And right now also in many places you can see this kind of chairs. Why? Because they had a aesthetic look, or that lures the customer to buy that thing. So even if you come across different shapes of cycles, then cars, all motorcycles, vehicles, fans, table design, furniture, then even you see milk containers. Earlier milk was carried in bottles, then it came in polypacks, and then now it is in tetra packs. Similarly, you see the different shapes of bottle, different shapes of glass, all these are having a commercial aspect. Now you see different type of sofa sets, different types of watches, different type of bicycle, different types of kitchen furniture. Then now even you see there are so many different shapes of masks have appeared in market. And then you see the dispensers, and then different kind of perfume bottles. All these things are nothing but the designs. Industrial designs, and they have a commercial value. You come across many sarees, different patterns on sarees, different clothes. All these are nothing but you see various different types of handicraft things. So These are nothing but the industrial designs, which are necessarily protected under the Designs Act, and therefore they have a commercial value, right? You see a jewelry set, a cutlery set, a furniture set, all these things are nothing but the industrial design. So whenever you think of any shape of one thing, that shape particularly relates to a design, and that design is also protected under the Designs Act, and therefore it has a commercial value. So that are applied on articles of trade, and which because of which it lures the customer to buy that thing. So that is nothing but the ornamental or aesthetic look of an article. So this indicates that the product, this product has a different shape, and therefore that design is being registered under the Designs Act. So coming to this design also, I suppose everything is clear. We will, in the last latter part of our session, we will ask for the questions, if any. Then coming to important thing, that is patent. So when you talk of patent, what is patent? Every day you come across this word, many time you people, you also say, are iska to ye patented word hai, ye patented dialogue hai, iska ye patent hai, uska wo patent hai. What is exactly the patent? So let us understand what is patent. So patent is an, again, one of the intellectual property right relating to inventions. Now here I want to make one thing very clear, that when you are talking of patent, you should necessarily understand that it is related to invention. So whenever you file an application for patent, it should necessarily contain an invention. Now what is that invention? Invention, there is a difference between invention and discovery. So mind you, many people, many scientists, many students or many research scholars come to us by giving some examples of discoveries, and then we have to necessarily reject that application, stating that it is not an invention, this is a discovery. So basically, before filing an any application for patent, you should understand that the invention, there should be an invention and not a discovery. Now, one of the example which we talk of discovery is just like when Christopher Columbus was walking, or when he was going somewhere, he found America, accidentally he found America. America was there. It was basically present in the nature, but then it was basically there. But when he found out, he was the first person who has found out America. Similarly, Vasco da Gama. Vasco da Gama came on the Calicut beach and he found India. So this is nothing but the discovery. So whatever thing that is already present in nature and somebody accidentally finds it out, that may be in the form of minerals or any other thing which was already in existence. But has anybody seen a mobile phone or a watch or a fan or a car lying anywhere in the nature? No, it is a result of human intervention. There has been a human intervention. The human efforts are being put. Brain has thought of some idea, that has idea has resulted into that kind of thing. So a lot of experimentation, a lot of research work, a lot of trials, a lot of things, a lot of human intervention is required to create an invention. So basically, when you talk of patent, you should understand that there should be a patent, or there should be a necessarily an invention. That invention may be in the form of product or a process. So patent is an intellectual property right relating to invention. It is an exclusive and monopoly right granted to inventor. So once we say that it is an exclusive monopoly right granted to patent by government for a period of 20 years. Generally now the patent term is 20 years. And during once you get the monopoly, thus you can prevent others from making, using, importing or selling the claimed invention in exchange of his disclosure of his invention. So what has happened? So suppose Sanjay Sapkar sir invents something, and he invents that thing and he gets the patent in that thing. So once he invents, what happens? He has to necessarily disclose whatever invention he has made to the patent office. He has to come to patent office. He has to file an application for patent stating that I invented this kind of thing and I need a protection. So once that patent, the invention is registered as a patent, then Dr. Sapkar gets a period of 20 years for using this invention, and he has an exclusive monopoly right. So during that tenure, nobody can use. Otherwise he can sell license, he can give assignments, or he can sell that patented invention to the public. So that is nothing but when that has to be necessarily disclosed to the patent office. And once this period of 20 years is over, the invention goes in public domain, and then public is free to use that invention. So monopoly ends after the period of 20 years. Now, what are the basic requirements apart from that? Now you will say that, Aray, sir, you told me that patents are granted only to invention. So I have invention, now grant me a patent. Then we have to necessarily see the basic requirements. Further basic requirements are, there should be novelty. There should be novelty, there should be inventive step, and there should be industrial applicability. What is this basic thing? So whenever you think of word patent, patents relates to invention. That invention should be a product or a process, and that product has to be necessarily satisfy the requirement of novelty, inventive step, and industrial applicability. What is novelty? Novelty is in the form of, that means the invention should be new, not a copied work. It should not be published somewhere else. Kidhar se, nobody should have copied from any other's work. So nobody should come out of somebody's copied work and say that I have got the invention. No, we have a dedicated team of examiners wherein serious search has been conducted, or a search has been conducted to find out the novelty. So basically understand that the invention should be new, it should not be a copied work, it should not be a published work, it should not be available to public on the date of the filing of your patent application. So that has to be necessarily a new thing. Okay. When you cross the new thing hurdle, once we find that your invention is new, then we go for inventive step. What is inventive step? Again, section 21J of the Patent Act says that inventive step is that feature of invention that has technical advancement or economic significance, or both, or anyone is sufficient on the date of filing of the invention. Now, what is that technical advancement? Earlier, you see, during the earlier period, when the computers came, we were using the floppy disks, right? That was storing some MB data, right? Then came the period of pen drives with 2GB, 1GB, 3GB, and basically that resulted in the storage of data. That is nothing but the technical advancement. The use of floppy stopped, and then people started using the pen drive. Similarly, when we had a cassette players, then CD players, then VCD players, all these are nothing but the technical advancement. So technical advancement means something new, which was cassette player was there and cassettes were being played, though that thing was in existence, but when technology developed, they have come with a CD player or a VCD player. So that is nothing but the technical advancement. So you can now your cassette used to play only one movie song, but when you come to a CD compact disc, it started playing 100 20 30 movie songs. So that is nothing but the we can say that is nothing but the technical advancement. You see, when we were using the traditional telephones, now that came with the cordless, then basically pagers, and then mobile phone. Now there are different sort of inventions in the mobile phone. That is nothing but the technical advancement. And now what is economic significance? Earlier, when the televisions came that were costing more. Now you see there are many television producing companies which are charging a less amount, or the cost have been drastically reduced. So that is nothing but the economic signal. For example, a drug, a medicine that was costing rupees 100 for a strip of 10 tablets. And now you come across with a same type of tablet with only 50 rupees cost or a 20 rupees cost. And then we can say that there is definitely an economic advantage and economic significance is there. So on the basis of that, we can say that the invention is having an inventive step. Then again, third part comes, that is of industrial applicability. So what is industrial applicability? That means you should be able to produce n number of articles of that invention. You should not block the technology by taking a patent of a particular invention. So basically the idea is that you should make it publicly available, reasonable requirement of public, as well as the reasonable cost should be charged. And that is what the industrial applicability relates. So you should be able to produce in n number of things so that the reasonable requirement of public is satisfied. You had seen Remdesivir injection. Remdesivir was having a patent by Gilead Life Sciences, but when the epidemic came, it immediately became an instant hit, and because of which the company was not able to meet the requirement. So government has necessarily asked them to license that thing. So Gilead has given almost 8 compulsory licenses to this company, so that the company started producing the Remdesivir, and then the reasonable requirement of public was met with when the 8 licenses were granted. So this is nothing but the industrial applicability. So basically understand that when you talk of patent, you should understand it is an exclusive monopoly right for a period of 20 years in exchange of disclosure. That should be necessarily related to invention, that may be in the form of product, or there should be in the form of process. Plus, there should be the invention should be new, not known to anybody. Then there should be technical advancement or economic signification. And further, there should be industrial applicability. That is what relates to the patent. So I suppose this is very clear with you, because this is the very important slide, and which gives the gist of what is patent. Right. Now coming to patents. Now, once you understand that patents are nothing but the old form of intellectual protection. So you see, during the 16th, 17th centuries, there were emperors, there were kings who used to ask their cooks to produce particular dish. And if the cook makes some special dish, and if the king likes it, the king or the emperor used to give him some award. So award, and also he was given a monopoly that the dish who should be prepared by that cook only, or that cook only was asked to prepare that kind of dish. So this was a part of patent protection during earlier days also. So the age of patent, history of patent, is as old as in the 16th, 17th centuries. Now basically understand, the aim is to encourage the economic and technological development by rewarding the intellectual creativity. So basically, once somebody, it is necessarily that patents, one, if anybody wants to produce that patent, or one wants to create an invention. So the basic intention of the aim of the patent system is to encourage or to motivate the economic as well as the technical technological development of the country by rewarding the intellectual creativity. We know the stronger the intellectual property protection in the country, the more development of that country, the country is said to be technically developed or technically advanced. So it's because when we have a strong intellectual property regime, right? Now this is one of the example of patent, that is the first patent granted in 1856 to a civil engineer, George Alfred Defenning, a pulling pankha machine. So this was the patent which was granted in 1856 during the even before the independence. That is nothing but the history. So that is again, when you come across semiconductor integrated circuits layout and design. Now, what are these? These are again the layouts, designs of integrated circuits. So whenever you come across this kind of circuits, where you see this kind of circuits, or where you see these kind of things, these are usually present in the motherboard, or in the laptop or computer or mobile phone, or in a television. So whenever this electronic circuit is there, or whenever this indicator, semiconductor integrated circuits are there, and which give something fruitful, then that has to be necessarily protected under the Semiconductor Integrated Circuits Layout Act. This is nothing but, for your knowledge, this is also one of the important intellectual properties. So don't get confused. So whenever you see these kind of things are registered under the Semiconductor Integrated Circuits Layout and Designs Act. So this is also basically one of the intellectual property rights. As Section 3 of the Indian Patent Act bars that intellectual property of semiconductor integrated circuits cannot be registered. So to make that thing registered, or to make the advantage given to the public, whatever you say, that IC chips or the electronic circuits which are being used, so that necessarily indicates that the semiconductor integrated circuit has to be protected. So this is nothing but the one of the coming field which is coming in the information technology information technology aspect, right? Now, coming to trade secrets. Another important intellectual property is trade secrets. Now, what is a trade secret? A trade secret is any practice or a process of a company that is generally not known outside the company, and information is considered as trade secret as it gives the company an economic advantage over its competitors and is often a product of internal research and development. Now, what is happening with here is the trade secret, because they keep the things secret to themselves, and they maintain that secrecy by signing an agreement of confidentiality. So nobody knows what kind of things or how that trade secret is. For example, every day we are using Google, right? So whenever you want to search something, immediately one says, go and search in Google. Now, what is that Google? So once you put some keywords in Google and you search, you get n number of documents, or there are more than one document, or there are hundreds of documents that are coming in immediately once you click the search button. So what is that? What is the algorithm? So Google has kept that search algorithm a trade secret. It is not disclosed to anybody, but it is of that algorithm. Once you press that kind of words in that thing, the algorithm goes and search. That is the Google search engine is kept as a trade secret. It is neither patented nor copyrighted, or nothing has been done. They have kept that material as a trade secret. Similarly, you see of KFC fried chicken. That KFC fried chicken is nothing but the recipe, which is being kept as a trade secret. Nobody knows how that KFC fried chicken is made. So that is kept as a trade secret. Similarly, you see one of the good example is Coca-Cola. Coca-Cola, then WD-40 anti-rusting oil. Then again, McDonald's Big Macs, that is the mustard sauce, which has been again kept as a trade secret. So it is not known to anybody, and it is still protected under the agreement of confidentiality. So this is nothing but the undisclosed information or trade secret. So they have a competitive edge in business world. Confidential information includes the information that qualifies as a trade or a business secret. So this is kept as a secret. Now you see one good example of Coca-Cola. Earlier, what happened? The company has patented the Coca-Cola in 1893. Now that period was, during that period, patents was for 14 years. So once the patent got lapsed, the patented Coca-Cola got publicly available. Then public started preparing it and they lost their protection. Now what happened? They prepared another formula of making Coca-Cola, and now that Coca-Cola, they have kept it as a trade secret. And till date, you will have the same taste or same flavor of the Coca-Cola, which is almost the same as 100 and 150 years. So it is one of the thing that is kept as a copyright. That is kept as a trade secret. There are many stories stating that the partners of this Coca-Cola never go in a same flight, or never go in one car, because they are fearing that accident may lead to their death or something like that, and because of which the trade secret will go. So these people don't prefer to go outside. These are all the stories, but the fact is that they have kept the thing as a trade secret, and still it is kept not known to anybody how that Coca-Cola is produced. The formula is known only to the two persons who are the partners of the company. So this is about the trade secret. And then coming to another intellectual property, that is protection of plant varieties and farmers' right. So this is also one of the budding thing that is also the intellectual property. We come across different types of plant varieties, roses. Then you see capsicum. Earlier we used to have green and red capsicum, but then nowadays we are coming across yellow and different shape of capsicums, or different sorts of roses, then different shapes of fruits. Nowadays you see a new variety of sitapal is being coming with a different look and different sort of taste. So these are nothing but the different plant. Then when you talk of BT brinjal or BT cotton, all these are the new varieties of plant that has to be necessarily protected under the Protection of Plant Varieties and Farmers Right Act. So this is nothing but the another sort of intellectual property. Now roughly to summarize, we have seen what is patent, what is trademark, what is design, what is geographical indication, copyright, plant protection, and integrated circuits. So when we talk of this is the strong strong Indian intellectual property regime, and wherein patents are protected or governed by the patent law. And I told you its registration is compulsory and it's for a period of 20 years. Similarly, trademarks are registered under the Trademarks Act. Its registration is optional and it's for a period of 10 years and it is renewable forever. Then coming to industrial designs, they are again governed by the Designs Act that is protected for a period of 10 years, plus it is renewable by another 5 years. Similarly, geographical indications are governed by the Geographical Indications of Goods and Protection Act 1999. Again, its registration is compulsory 10 years plus renewable forever. Then copyright, again, I told you it is governed by the Copyright Act as and when amended. Then further, it's I told you that its registration is optional, but you can register it. And it pertains to the lifetime of the author plus 60 years from his death. Then coming to plant protection, again, it is governed by the Protection of Plant Varieties and Farmers' Rights Act 2001. Again, its registration is compulsory. It's for a period of 15 to 18 years. Then again, integrated circuits. Again, they are protected under the Semiconductor Integrated Circuits Layouts Designs Act 2000. And its registration is compulsory and for a period of 10 years. So now for simple understanding, so you see, when you have an idea and you express it in some form, that may be in the form of literary, artistic, or musical, dramatic work, or in the form of cinematographic film or sound recording, that will necessarily be the topic of copyright and you will get a copyright protection. Similarly, when you have an idea that may relate to an invention or invention, innovation or an invention, that will necessarily lead to a patent. So when you have an idea and its quality and identity, then that becomes the subject matter of trademark. So you can apply for a trademark. Then when your idea that may be in the form of appearance, shape, designs, so that is nothing but the industrial design. So these are the simple things when the idea can be converted in what form of protection you can get. So this is basically what I have to say regarding the intellectual property. So there are these different types of intellectual properties. And I suppose I have made it very clear. Now, if you have any doubts, please feel free to ask me any questions from here right now. I request the management committee to unmute the participants and let them ask their any questions if they have. So any questions, the platform is open for question answer session. So you can ask me the questions if you want. Hello.
Yes, sir. So any students, any participants, do you have any questions so far?
So if you don't have any questions, then I will ask you some two, three questions. Will it be okay?
Yeah, yes, sir. Sure.
Or if anybody has any question or any doubts, please feel free to ask me freely right now. So is there any question?
Yes, any questions from any participants?
I suppose everything is clear then. Then I may shoot some questions at you, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay, now we will go for a quiz, just a small quiz to make it clear. Now, what is this first picture pertains to? What is this picture relates to? What kind of protection you can get if in this kind of picture? So we have dealt with all these types of intellectual property. So this is a picture of?
Hello? This is a picture of Mona Lisa and it is done through copyright, sir.
Right, very good, very good. Then the second picture. Second picture is a sculpture work. So what is that sculpture work related with? That is again an artistic work, right? So where it should be protected? Where it should be protected? Kaha iska protection lena chahiye?
Main sang tenu ko kai te chahe karu fakta to ghagra vatun nahi jaye.
Hello. Can anybody answer? Again, it is a copyright work. Then you see. Then you see third picture indicating a mobile phone and some mark is there. What is that? I suppose nobody is answering. Nobody is interacting. Are they mute or unmute? Or you didn't get anything?
Yes, sir. They are allowed to unmute.
Okay,
yes,
then they should answer. What is the third picture related with? Can anybody tell me? There's a one mark clearly seen in that thing. What is that thing? What you can see in the picture number 3?
Sir, industrial design.
Okay, we can say industrial design, but there is a mark. What does that mark indicate? That is the mark of which company?
Apple, sir.
Apple. So that has to be a trademark also. Then that is mobile or computer also. Then that may be also part of invention. So that may be again governed by the patent also. Similarly, what is picture number 4 Bisleri indicating? Now I told you many times Bisleri. Bisleri kya hai?
Trademark.
A trademark, right. So these are the things that has to be necessarily. Then if you see what is 5th, there is a name Coca-Cola written on bottle. So that is again a shape.
Trade secret.
No, that is okay. That is a trade secret. But now this is having a bottle is having a particular shape. So that is necessarily a design also, right? The word Coca-Cola is there, that is necessarily a trademark also. The way it is written or the way it is shown, that may be copyrighted also. So there are, see, every day you come across this kind of intellectual property. For example, if you have a pen in your hand and you see the pen, how many intellectual properties? Can anybody tell me how many intellectual properties are present in a pen? Every day you are using these different intellectual properties, but you are not aware of. So can anybody tell me how many intellectual properties are present in the pen? Okay, design. Everybody has a pen. The pen has different shape and different design. So necessarily it has a design. Then it is sold by some brand name. That may be in the form of Cello, Parker, Montex, or any other rewrite, Reynolds. So that is nothing but a trademark. Now you come across many pens wherein you say that German technology ink or the 0.45 tip or something tip is there or some German flow ink or all these things are nothing but a Japanese technology floated with that. So that is nothing but an inventive part. So there is some invention also. Then again, I told you the literature, how it works. The literature can also be in the form of copyright. So basically, when you start using all these things, you come across the intellectual property every day in every period of life. Mobile phone, this is having a brand name that may be of Nokia, that may be of Samsung, Redmi, Realme, or any other thing that are nothing but the trade names, the designs of different shapes, then the technology that is associated with, that is also again a patented thing, 3 cameras, 2 cameras, 4 cameras, different sort of speed, all this is nothing but the intellectual property. So this is what we wanted to convey. I suppose everything is clear with you, and if you have any doubts, you can ask me. Otherwise, you can I have given my email address to Sanjay Sapka sir, and if you have any questions, you can ask me privately also. Or through email also. So if any questions are there, please feel free to ask me right now. So I suppose everything is clear now. And with this, I will say thank you for silent and patient hearing. And I hope you got the things of what is at least a glimpse of what is intellectual property, different types of intellectual property, and what kind of things are registered under the different domains of the intellectual property. That may be in the form of trademark, copyright, geographical indications, patents, copyright, trade secret, all other things. So that is fine from my end. Now, if you have anything, you can feel or you can go ahead with the session.
Yes, thanks a lot, Ajay Thakur sir, for sharing this wonderful knowledge about IPR and several different aspects of intellectual property rights. So on behalf of entire IIC team and Dr. V. Ambedkar Institute of Management Studies, I would like to again like thank to spare your time for our students and our staff members and sharing this wonderful knowledge. Thank you so much, sir.
Okay. Thank you. One yes, humble sir. Request, you please send the list of the participants who have appeared for this seminar or who participated, so that we can take care of their certificates along with your institution certificate also. So just send me one email, okay?
Yes, yes, definitely, sir. Thank you so much, sir.
Yes. Yes. So I will take your leave. Thank you so much. Thank you so much. Have a good day.
And we also would like to thank Sanjay Sakpal, sir, for connecting IIC cell with Dr. Ajay Thakur, sir, and conducting this session. Thank you, sir.
Thank you.
I would request participant that a feedback link would be posted on the chat box as well as on the WhatsApp group regarding this session. So please submit your feedback by today evening. Okay. Thank you.